I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is.
raise your own hallelujah. I can't do it for you. There's a song written on your heart, only you can sing. And when you sing, the enemies flee. When you sing, prison walls come falling down. When you sing, heaven invades the earth. So just begin to lift up your hallelujah. Raise it like a banner. Raise it like a flag. Raise it in the middle of the storm. Let it rise. Let it rise. Like a symphony in the key. Everything here, Jesus. We raise it all
you came the morning. Glad to have this time with you again. What an incredible range of emotions these last few weeks have been. For many believers, we're rejoicing with the crowds upon Jesus' triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem, Palm Sunday. We saw how he entered into the acclaim of the crowds and the shouts of Hosanna, and blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. And peace in heaven and glory in the highest. This officially marked the beginning of the Lord's Passion Week. The timeline for that week looked like this. Jesus' cleansing of the temple on Monday. Jesus sharing his teachings to his disciples on Tuesday. Judas arranging for the betrayal of Judas with the chief priests on Wednesday. Jesus sharing the Last Supper with his disciples, then moving into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, followed by Jesus' arrest by the temple authorities and the flight of his disciples, the denial of Peter. All of this happened on Thursday. The hearing of Jesus before Ananias, the trial of Jesus before Caiaphas, the trial of Jesus before the rest of the Sanhedrin, and then the trial of Jesus before Pilate. And the trial of Jesus moved then on to King Herod. Then the condemnation of Jesus by the crowds, Jesus' mocking, his beating, and then his crucifixion. His death on the cross, the sun darkened, the earth shook, the veil in the Holy of Holies was torn. The Lord's body was removed from the cross and hurriedly placed in a borrowed tomb, and the stone was rolled in front of the tomb's entrance. This all took place on Friday. The tomb was sealed, and the Jewish chief priests requested that Pilate have Roman guards posted outside the tomb. All of this took place on Saturday. On Sunday, the Easter story reveals the women went to the tomb and found the Roman guards had fled and the stone had been rolled away. The angel appeared to them, and the angel said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen, just as he said." Then later that day, the Lord appeared to Peter and then to two of his disciples on the road to Emmaus. And then again to to all of the other disciples but Thomas. He would appear and speak to him along with the others later that next week. The emotional highs and lows experienced and the frenetic level of activity in just 1 week would be enough to give even the most even-keeled and proficient multitaskers pause for thought. How could all of this happen in the span of just 1 week? And maybe a thought of, how is it that in the midst of so much chaos and confusion, turmoil and tension, did Jesus remain focused on his mission, while at the same time amazingly able to stay focused on meeting the needs of his disciples and those around him? And then too, how is it that the disciples failed to see his care and concern for them in the midst of all of this? All things aside, while it was most assuredly the Lord's finest hour, it was certainly not the disciples. In a truly transparent manner, the New Testament writers reveal all of the disciples' faults and foibles, their failings. How is it that the disciples could manage to allow fear to cause them to question the faith they had in Jesus Christ as risen Savior, Lord, and King? They just couldn't see past what their heads and hearts could grasp, what their ears had heard, what their eyes had seen. They had allowed fear to eclipse their faith. I don't want to be too rough on those disciples. After all, I can't help but think how this time of great uncertainty for us as believers today mirrors what they've gone through. We tend to react in much the same way as people. Times of uncertainty, times of trial and trouble and testing of our faith always reveal what our faith is in, who our faith is in, and how much faith we really have, and what we're willing to allow that faith to inform and influence. Can I say to you all today, we are all, each one of us today, on a road to Emmaus. And understanding that what we think and what we say, how we respond determines our next steps, either in faith or in fear. What I mean is this, as we travel this time of uncertainty, as we're thinking about what Jesus had said, as we're talking with each other about the promises of God, are we allowing those truths of God's word to not only wash over us, but work itself out in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions, in such a way as to allow that faith that we say we have in Jesus Christ to inform and influence our decisions, our steps moving forward in such a time as this? It comes down to this. It's either faith or fear that we'll allow to inform and influence how we think, how we speak, and how we act in times of uncertainty. You have heard me say, people are people. Whether it was 1,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago or today, people are people. By that I mean we all have the same needs and wants and desires, concerns and cares. Let me share with you today a word of truth. In times of trial and trouble and testing, we will either flourish in faith or falter in fear. Join me in Luke chapter 24, picking up in verse 13. The scripture says, "Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, 'What are you discussing together as you walk along?' They stood, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, 'Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? What things, he asked. About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hope that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. They did not see Jesus. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scripture to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, 'Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have.' When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, 'Do you have anything here to eat?' They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and he ate it in their presence. He said to them, 'This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms.' Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, 'This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high.'" Some things in this text help us to see just what I was referring to earlier. Number one, are we talking and walking with faith and with fear? John MacArthur's commentary on the text reveals they had been looking for an immediate earthly kingdom. With Jesus crucified, they were probably struggling with doubt and whether he was the Messiah who would reign. But they still regarded him as a true prophet. There may have been a glimmer of hope in these words. They had heard rumors of the resurrection already. Perhaps Cleopas recalled the Lord's promises. More likely, however, it seems this was his way of expressing surprise that the stranger did not know the news that everyone else in Jerusalem had been discussing for the past 3 days. As we are thinking about this, we need to ask ourselves, are we talking and walking with faith or with fear? And at times like this, we have a tendency to look for an immediate resolution to the circumstances we find ourselves in. And in our struggles, we too have a tendency to allow doubts to fill our heads and in our hearts, causing us to question, were his promises true? Was he really the one, or should we look elsewhere for hope? When we do, we aren't talking or walking with faith. It is fear that informs and influences our steps. Jesus comes alongside each of us and prompts us, what are you discussing together as you walk along? The Lord in his care and concern for us comes alongside of us and talks with us, walks with us along the same stretch of road and calls us to think about what we are talking about. Is it the truth? He's asking us to think about what we're thinking about and talking about as we walk this stretch of road. Friends, what we think on our minds will then inform and influence our emotions to react on. And what our minds and hearts are focused on, our souls and strengths will then act on. Stephen J. Covey, author of the highly acclaimed book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, wrote, sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. Covey was building on a quote by Gandhi who said, your beliefs become your thoughts. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your habits. Your habits become your values. And your values become your destiny. Both were actually building on a text. It's found in God's Word, Proverbs 23:7. It's a familiar text to many. It begins, for as he thinks within himself, so is he. It's been translated in a more contemporary context to say, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. I want to challenge us all today to ask ourselves, are we talking and walking with faith or with fear? My second point today. Are we able to see him at work in the midst of the circumstances? These two disciples of Christ were not of the 12 that so often we read about in the Gospels. They were of the much broader circle of believers, the 120 we are seeing referenced in the book of Acts. These believers all made up the early church. Having left the city of Jerusalem after the crucifixion of the Lord and likely fearing persecution, these two were returning to their homes. They had not yet heard of the Lord's resurrection in detail. They'd heard only rumors. Their conversation was centered only on the arrest, the trials, the condemnation by the chief priests and the crowds who had shouted for his crucifixion. They had seen how Pilate had acquiesced to the crowd's demand to release Barabbas and crucify Christ. They may have even watched from a distance how Jesus would struggle under the strain and stress, the load of the cross, up that dark road to Calvary. Likely in the midst of that crowd's uproar and all the chaos and the confusion, they panicked and fled the area, made their way out of town. And as the sky grew dark and the earth quaked, they were leaving all of this behind. What now? What will we do now? Surely for these two, hope was lost. Their faith in Christ as Savior and Lord and King were shaken. All these two could think about, talk about, as they walked about, were what had happened to them. What they had seen happen around them, the news that they had heard. They were surprised that this stranger had not heard of all that. After all, it was the news of Jerusalem. what everyone else was thinking about, what everyone else was talking about. When the Lord Jesus prompted them about what they were thinking about, what they were talking about as they walked with his question, what things? It wasn't because he didn't already know the answer. I believe it was his way of getting them to refocus their thinking and their talking about what was right and not what they thought had gone wrong. In a Psychological Today article, Reframing the Transformative Power of Suffering by Linda and Charlie Bloom, dated December 14th, 2017, they write, "One of the skills to help us develop as mature, resilient individuals is that of reframing. When we change our point of view on any given situation, the facts remain the same, but the deliberate shift is made in how we see it. We can replace the dismal, energy-stealing thoughts with more responsible ones, such as, I think there must be something important for me to learn here. These are examples of reframing problems as challenges and taking them on as such. As we shift our thinking about a situation, there's a change in emotional tone and the meaning that we give to our life circumstances. We can choose to move our experiences from a negative frame to a more hopeful one, filled with opportunities. This process allows us an expanded view of our reality. Reframing requires seeing something in a new way, in a context that allows us to recognize and appreciate positive aspects of our situation. Reframing helps us to use whatever life hands us as opportunities to be taken advantage of, rather than problems to be avoided. Breakdowns are transformed into challenges and new possibilities to experience life more fully and become a more whole human being. Reframing is not a denial that the challenges that we have been dealt with are difficult ones. Even though our circumstance may be fraught with hardship, we can learn to trust the cycle of life. We discover that this is a process of life that repeats itself, as do the cycles of summer, fall, winter, and then rebirth in spring. Through an understanding and trust of this transformative process, we come to have a faith that periods of decline, whether they last for minutes or months, can become periods of vibrancy. We are less likely to be possessed by ongoing moods of pessimism, hopelessness, or resentment. Our prevailing attitude becomes one that is more optimistic. The Lord knew they needed to be reminded of the truths of God's word. And so he said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." The Lord had to help them by redirecting their thoughts to the truths of God's word and helping them to reframe what had happened so they could see the truth standing before them. Why? Because they couldn't see what was right in front of them. Jesus in their midst, with them. God with them. Their focus on all that had gone wrong caused them to miss what was right about him, right there in their midst. When they took the time to listen, to allow the word of God as spoken by the Lord to fill their minds, flood their hearts, it would flow out into their actions. As they broke bread with the Lord, the word of God says, "Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him." I want to challenge us all today to reframe the circumstances we find ourselves in and to look and see what we can learn from it, from the Lord. And then redirect our thoughts, our attentions to God's word, and to see what he says about himself and about these times we're in. And I believe that when we do so, we'll see where God's at work around us. I believe we'll see our eyes opened to recognize him. He is with us. he has been all along. Thirdly, are we living with a faith informed and influenced by his word? What a difference it made for those two to have spent this quality time with the Lord, and it will for us as well. Having been redirected to the truths of God's word about the Lord and led by the Lord to see the things in light of God's word, then it helped these two disciples to reframe the circumstances they experienced. And what a difference it made. The text reveals they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, it is true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon. Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke bread with them. Remember now how at the beginning of our text we read how the two disciples on the road to Emmaus were leaving Jerusalem, walking and talking about all that had happened, their faces downcast when the Lord Jesus met them on the road. Look at these two disciples now. Following their encounter with the risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, what a difference having been redirected to the truths of God's word and having had those truths reminded to them, then being led of the Lord to reframe all that they had experienced over those last days. How it made a huge difference. The text reveals that instead of leaving Jerusalem downcast, filled with doubts and anxieties, fear and subject to a sense of hopelessness and helplessness, these two disciples got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and the rest of the disciples, and when they found them, they shared, it is true, he is risen. What we see here is a transformation from fear to faith. These two disciples had been redirected to the truths of God's word by the Lord Jesus himself, who then used those truths from God's word to help them reframe all that they had experienced over those last days. And as a result, fear no longer informed or influenced what they thought, what they spoke about, or what they acted on. Instead of fear, it was a renewed faith in a risen Savior, Lord, and King. Jesus Christ now informed and influenced their thoughts, their speech, and their actions. My question for us is, are we living with a faith that's informed and influenced by his word? So what's the takeaway for us from this text today? Do you remember the quote I shared with you by Gandhi? Your beliefs become your thoughts become your words become your actions, and your actions become your habits, and your habits become your values become your destiny. Maybe it would help us if I redirected our thoughts this way so we can reframe the truth for our present situation. Psalm 23 helps us do just that, revealing the truth of God's word. I'll read it for you. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Allow me to redirect us all to verse 4 of that psalm again. The truths of God's word reads, even though I walk through the darkest valley, or as some translations read, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. John Newton, the once slave trafficker turned believer, then English poet and Anglican clergyman, also the author and composer of that beautiful hymn we all know as Amazing Grace, wrote, "If the Lord be with us, we have no cause of fear. His eye is upon us, his arm over us, his ear open to our prayer, his grace sufficient, his promise unchangeable." In the light of God's word, God's promise, and this encouraging truth shared by Newton, let us reframe all that's happened in these last days in the light of God's word and allow that truth that we've been redirected to inform and influence what we think about, what we talk about, and what we act on in faith. Until next time, be blessed, church. My prayer for today and for you always is, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he be gracious unto you, that he make his face to smile upon you and give you his peace.